There are three cranial fossae, anterior, middle and posterior. Anterior cranial fossa, this one middle cranial fossa, and this one is the posterior cranial fossa. This cranial fossae forms the base of the skull and they are named from anterior to posterior. Regarding their depth, the posterior cranial fossa is the deepest, followed by middle cranial fossa and anterior cranial fossa. That means depth wise, posterior cranial fossa has the maximum depth, whereas middle cranial fossa is intermediate in depth and anterior cranial fossa is the shallowest. Now, as regards the floor of the middle cranial fossa, the floor of the middle cranial fossa resembles a butterfly. Butterfly shaped. It is consisting of a small median part. Small median part and an expanded lateral part on each side. Expanded lateral part on each side. Now the middle cranial fossa is demarcated from the anterior cranial fossa by number one, the posterior free border of lesser wing of sphenoid. This is posterior free border of lesser wing of sphenoid. It is to be noted hereby that lesser wings are two triangular plates. Lesser wings, they are two triangular plates projecting laterally from the body of sphenoid. Body of sphenoid. Each of them presents a base. A tip a superior surface that we can see from above then an anterior border this one and the posterior border. So posterior border of lesser wing of sphenoid demarcates the middle cranial fossa from the anterior cranial fossa. Along with it, there is this thing which is called limbus sphenoidalis. Limbus sphenoidalis. The limbus sphenoidalis is an anterior edge of a shallow transverse area called sulcus chiasmaticus. sulcus, caius maticus. This shallow transverse groove, which is known as sulcus caius maticus, is bounded in front by limbus sphenoidalis, and its posterior edge is formed by another transverse ridge, which is called tuberculum sellii. Tuberculum sellii. Okay. So, if we combine all of them, we will get the anterior boundary of the middle cranial fossa. And this anterior boundary demarcates the anterior cranial fossa from the middle cranial fossa. So, what is the anterior boundary then? The anterior boundary is formed by the posterior border of lesser wing of sphenoid. Posterior border of lesser wing of sphenoid. Then, anterior clinoid process. This anterior clinoid process. Anterior clinoid process. It is a projection that we get when we trace the posterior border of lesser wing medially. It is a triangular projection. Then the limbus sphenoidalis, which is the anterior margin of sulcus caius maticus. Then the anterior clinoid process of the opposite side, and again the posterior border of lesser wing of sphenoid. So there goes the anterior boundary of the middle cranial fossa, which separates the middle cranial fossa from the anterior cranial fossa. Next, we will consider the posterior boundary. How the middle cranial fossa is demarcated from the posterior cranial fossa? The middle cranial fossa is demarcated from the posterior cranial fossa by number A, the superior border of petrous temporal bone. This is the superior border of petrous temporal bone. On each side, and dorsum sellii, which is a rectangular plate of bone in the median region. So, in the median region, it is dorsum sellii. In the median region, which is a rectangular plate of bone. So, if we join the posterior boundaries, then we get the demarcation between the middle cranial fossa and the posterior cranial fossa. So, the demarcation, line of demarcation between the middle and posterior cranial fossa runs like this. Okay. So, the overall boundary of the middle cranial fossa, taken together the anterior and the posterior boundary of the middle cranial fossa together, will resemble the shape of a butterfly, the fact which has already been mentioned earlier. First, we discuss the median part of middle cranial fossa. The median part of the middle cranial fossa is formed by the body of sphenoid, which is more or less cuboidal. So, median part of middle cranial fossa is formed by body of sphenoid. Body of sphenoid is essentially a cuboidal structure, and in the view, we are seeing only the superior surface of the body of sphenoid. The median region from before backward presents the following features. First of all is the sulcus chiasmaticus. Sulcus chiasmaticus. It is a shallow transverse groove, which is also known as optic groove. And when it is stretched laterally, then it leads to the optic canal. Now, as the name suggests, sulcus chiasmaticus, the optic chiasma is related to it. But this optic chiasma does not occupy the sulcus, rather it lies on a higher level, well behind the sulcus. So optic chiasma lie at a higher level over the sulcus. Now when I go to the lateral aspect of the sulcus chiasmaticus, I get to see the optic canal. This optic canal leads to the orbit. Okay. Optic canal guides us to the orbit. So if a probe is introduced to the optic canal, it will go to the orbit. This optic canal is bounded laterally by the lesser wing of sphenoid. This is the lesser wing of sphenoid. In front and behind by two roots of lesser wing, roots of lesser wing, and medially by the body of sphenoid. Body of sphenoid. As regarding sulcus chiasmaticus, which is a shallow transverse groove, it has got two edges. The anterior edge of the sulcus chiasmaticus is known as limbus sphenoidalis. Limbus sphenoidalis, and the posterior edge of the sulcus chiasmaticus, it is known as the tuberculum sellii. Okay, now behind the tuberculum sellii there is a shallow depression which is known as the pituitary fossa or hypophyseal fossa. This hypophyseal fossa or pituitary fossa is representative of the upper surface of the body of sphenoid. Upper surface of body of sphenoid. Okay. Now, cella tarsica is a term. Cella tarsica. It is a term which is also employed to refer to the pituitary fossa or hypophyseal fossa. So, cella tarsica, pituitary fossa, and hypophyseal fossa, they are used interchangeably. This hypophyseal fossa or pituitary fossa or cella tarsica is bounded in front by the tuberculum cellae. Which is the posterior edge of sulcus chiasmaticus, already been discussed. And behind by dorsum cellae. Okay. The dorsum cellae is basically a transverse plate of bone projecting upward. And it forms the back of the cella tarsica. So, cella tarsica is a collective term. Cella tarsica. It refers to the following structure from before backward. Number one is the tuberculum cellae. Next is the hypophyseal fossa. And number three, the dorsum cellae. These three together are known as the cella tarsica. Now, important to note is that the tuberculum cellae, when traced laterally, ends up in a projected part which is known as the middle crinoid process. Middle crinoid process. So, middle crinoid process is the lateral end of the tuberculum cellae. Lateral end of tuberculum cellae. Similarly, dorsum cellae, which forms the back of the cella tarsica, which means the tarsus saddle, the lateral angle of dorsum cellae are expanded to form the posterior crinoid process. Posterior crinoid process, which refers to the lateral angles of dorsum cellae. Lateral angles of dorsum cellae. Okay. In short, the lateral ends of tuberculum cellae bear the middle crinoid processes and the lateral ends of the dorsum cellae bear the posterior crinoid processes. So, cella tarsica consisting of three parts, the tuberculum cellae, the hypophyseal fossa and the dorsum cellae. Now, there is a thing called carotid groove. Carotid groove. It is a shallow sulcus on either side of the body of sphenoid lateral to the hypophyseal fossa. You know, this is the hypophyseal fossa or pituitary fossa. So lateral to this fossa is a carotid groove. This begins at the foramen lacerum. Here is the foramen lacerum. In between the body of sphenoid and the petrous part of the temporal bone. Okay. And this carotid groove then runs upward and forward and finally upward again to end at the medial to the anterior clinoid process. This is the anterior clinoid process. So foramen lacerum is the beginning of the carotid groove and the ending of the carotid groove is the anterior clinoid process. Okay. The passage of internal carotid artery occupies this groove. Hence it is known as the carotid groove. Sometimes the middle and anterior clinoid processes are united by a bony bar forming carotidoclinoid foramen. Carotidoclinoid foramen, which is meant for the passage of internal carotid artery. Next, we discuss the important attachment in the middle cranial fossa. In the median plane, the tuberculum cellae provides attachment to the diaphragm cellae. So, tuberculum cellae provides attachment to diaphragm cellae. Diaphragm cellae is actually a circular dural fold which is attached onto the base of the skull and its anterior attachment is to the tuberculum cellae. The hypophyseal fossa itself lodges the hypophysis cerebri or the pituitary gland. The upper margin of the dorsum cellae provides the posterior attachment to the diaphragm cellae. So this again is giving attachment to diaphragm cellae. See? And the posterior clinoid process gives attachment to the anterior end of the attached margin of tentorium cerebelli and the petrosphenoidal ligament. So posterior clinoid process gives attachment to number one, the attached margin of tentorium cerebelli, attached margin of tentorium cerebelli plus petrosphenoidal ligament. Sphenoidal ligament. Okay. Now there is a term called cavernous sinus, which is a venous channel which lies on each side of the body of the sphenoid. The internal carotid artery which is lying on the carotid groove, it passes through the floor of the cavernous sinus. So here in the carotid groove lie the internal carotid artery. It lies at the groove of cavernous sinus. The internal carotid artery lie at the floor of cavernous sinus. Floor of cavernous sinus.